Hello and welcome to Rajya Sabha Television. You're watching The Big Picture with me, Frank Rausan Pereira. The Supreme Court today declared that adultery is not a crime and struck down the anti-adultery law, saying it was unconstitutional as it dented the individuality of women and treated them as a personal possession of husbands. The apex court's five-judge constitution bench was unanimous in striking down section 497 of the Indian Penal Code dealing with the offence of adultery and holding it as manifestly arbitrary and archaic law, which is violative of the rights to equality and equal opportunity to women. A five-judge bench comprising Chief Justice Dipak, Misra and Justices R.F. Nariman, A.M. Khanwilkar, D.Y. Chandrachud and Indu Malhotra said that unequal treatment of women invites the wrath of the Constitution. Adultery was punishable by a maximum 5 years in jail or fine or both. On this edition of The Big Picture, we will analyze the adultery verdict. Joining me on the program today are Aishwarya Bhati, advocate of the Supreme Court. Rahul Ishwar will join us on the phone line. Satya Prakash, legal editor of the Tribune, and Yogita Bhayana, social rights activist. All right. Thank you to all my guests for joining me on this edition of The Big Picture. Aishwarya Bhati, let's start the program with you. Let's try and put the verdict into perspective and your thoughts on the adultery verdict of the Supreme Court.
Well, it's a welcome verdict. But the writing was clear on the wall even during the arguments of the case. And it is interesting not just for the reason that adultery has been decriminalized, though the judgment is very clear that so it's just not a crime. It continues to be a civil wrong, a matrimonial wrong. Some portions of the judgment highlighted that this should not be taken as a tool for or an excuse for indulging into adultery. Now, we have to understand that the definition of adultery, the way it was treated in IPC, was completely different in the manner in which it is understood in matrimonial laws. Any sexual intercourse or sexual relationship with anybody outside the marriage is adultery, as it is commonly understood and as understood in the matrimonial law. The Indian Penal Code, which of course is archaic, the entire thing is archaic, it's a colonial borrowing that we have, but I must also say that all of IPC is brilliant law. But wherever portions of it have become irrelevant for the purpose have to be struck down, and it has been rightly struck down because this treated women as a chattel of the husband. It said that unless you have a sexual intercourse with the wife without the consent and connivance of the husband, then it would be treated as adultery. So it was completely warped. It turned itself completely on the head. And these judgments are not relevant just for this purpose. But I think they lay down a path. They become milestones in a journey for women's rights. And recognizing the dignity of a woman is a very strong and powerful and a robust notion which has been firmly grounded by many judgments, and this only takes it forward.
All right, let me bring in Rahul Ishwar now and look at the other side of the coin as well, because there's a very strong argument about what happens to Indian culture and Indian ethos. Rahul Ishwar. Rahul Ishwar, if you can hear me, let's talk about the other side of the argument as well. What about Indian ethos and Indian culture? Well, you seem to have lost the line with Rahul Ishwar there. Let me bring in Satya Prakash into the picture now. It's very clear from the verdict, and not just this verdict, Article 377 as well, that India, today's India, does not have place for Victorian era laws.
It's not Article 377, Section
377. I beg your pardon.
See, this judgment has to be seen in perspective, in the sense, in the recent past, the Supreme Court has delivered several verdicts, starting with the right to privacy verdict last year, and 377 you mentioned, and this one, 497. The Supreme Court's liberal approach is coming to the fore, and we can see how in the centrality of the discussion and debate, individual freedom, the court has given much more importance. So that way, as Vera has pointed out during the arguments also, it was very much clear that all the judges, they were against it, and they were going to strike it down. So it has been declared unconstitutional. What is important is, after this verdict, because this is a constitution bench verdict, its implications. Because what the court has said, it is not about permissiveness or promiscuity, no, nothing. It is about constitutional values and constitutional principles. Article 14, that is right to equality. Article 15, right to non-discrimination on the grounds of gender, religion, caste, blah blah. Here, the arbitrariness was manifest in, to the extent that, look at the provision. It's only an offense for men. Both ways. One, it treats women as a kind of chattel, and even penalizes only men, while both are parties to the so-called crime, which is no more a crime now. But the arbitrariness was completely manifest, and still it survived for so long on the statute book. And the Supreme Court in the past has upheld its validity. Despite Article 14 being there, Article 15 being there, it's also about the journey of the Supreme Court as a constitutional court, how it has evolved over the decades, and now it puts individual freedom at the forefront while deciding such issues. It's going to be guiding principle in future, and its impact on various other cases, because here they are striking at the arbitrariness of a particular law. And just if you apply this to say triple talaq case, in that case the Supreme Court chose not to deal with other issues, only it dealt with the instant triple talaq issue. If it this principle was to be applied to triple talaq, the other forms of triple talaq will also be struck down, to the extent that the right to utter talaq, it's only with husbands, not with wives. Wives can only seek talaq, that is right to khula. So that way, this verdict is going to have repercussions and ramifications for decades to come.
All right. Yogita Bayana, as far as this particular verdict is concerned, do you believe that it's a step forward in our effort towards moving towards a gender equal society?
I'll start my opening statement by saying what Chief Justice said, husband is not the master of a woman. And then Justice Chandrachud also said that women after marriage does not pledge her sexual autonomy to her husband, and depriving her of choice to have consensual sex with any of one outside the marriage cannot be curbed. So what else we can talk about gender equality? And Supreme Court all this last 1 year, as Ashwara Bharti also would agree, that has definitely shown progressive steps towards gender equality, and the time has come. Because no matter whatever we say, whatever we talk, and how many candle marches we take out, till the time this inequality doesn't go, I think we don't have any way forward. And Supreme Court has time and again has been showing way towards this whole progress. So I'm very happy as an activist, and definitely replications comes with every law. Maybe it will have. We will be, take it forward when it comes, and we'll see how to deal with them. But any which ways, to begin with, it's a good beginning, I would say.
Okay, a step in the right direction is what you're suggesting. Rahul Ishwar joins us on the phone line right now. Rahul Ishwar, looking at the other side of the coin, what happens to Indian ethos and Indian culture?
There are two things, sir. One, marriage and family are sacred and having sanctity according to our belief. And any legal framework or law should be encouraging it. That's the reason why we always point out, like Chief Justice rightly pointed out, that all the adultery can also be a result and a byproduct of broken marriages. So we need to fix marriages first, family first. That's the reason why we should be having real progressive things like family education and marital education law. For example, the U.S. state of Colorado had a marital education law, and many churches in India, the Christian community in India, is having a very good premarital education framework. We need such things. That's the real solution for it. Rather than a mechanical equality, we need gender equality plus gender complementarity, or gender uniqueness is a principle we should apply. That means the male and female should complement each other. See, in the name of liberalism or in the name of progressivism, we shouldn't destabilize the base of our family. Like Pope Francis once said, the future is family, and the family belongs to the future. So family as an institution should be protected, and we need such frameworks. That's the reason why we vouch for things like family education law, premarital education, proper parenting. These are the steps that we should take. I concede that in this particular law, the wording has been a bit archaic. That means, in effect, the woman was considered a property of a man. I think all right, responsible people on the other side of the spectrum too agree with that. There is a general consensus that such kind of wording doesn't suit a modern era and a modern democracy. I concede that. But having said that, We need framework which will in effect strengthen family and marriage and not weaken it. And that should be the spirit of your argument. And the present central government also gave an affidavit on the same line, where they said no dilution should be to any profession which will debase our ethos or our family system, which we all hold sacred and having sanctity.
Better family values going forward is what you're suggesting. Aishwarya Bhati wants to come in.
I want to tell Rahul ji that, you know, he has to be rest assured. Everyone respects family. You have to appreciate that everyone who is for the striking down of adultery as a criminal act also believes in fidelity of marriage. I mean, it's a sanctity that we all believe in, and nobody wants to have infidelity or promote infidelity. Family is a very important institution. It needs to carry our nation forward. But these kind of lopsided laws actually harm it more than protect it. You know, there is a saying in family law that having too many laws, and that too criminal laws, in a marriage is like having a bull in the china shop. We don't want too many bulls in the china shop. And today's judgment also makes an impact, makes a reference to that, that adultery is not usually the reason for a failed marriage. Adultery is usually a consequence of a failed marriage. So one needs to understand, and this kind of definition that was existing, I mean, then it had to be equal for all. Like if a man had a sexual relationship, a husband had a sexual relationship with an unmarried woman, then it would not amount to adultery in terms of the. And if you had consent and connivance of the husband, then also it would not amount to adultery. So it was really, really, lopsided, and it had to go. One thing about the journey of the Supreme Court, I think this is a verdict that actually shows that journey very beautifully, because there was a judgment earlier which upheld the constitutional validity of the adultery law on the very same grounds and reasons. And then there is one beautiful saying in one of the Supreme Court judgments of Constitution bench, that fundamental rights are like empty vessels, and every generation has to fill in its own wisdom in those vessels. So I think this generation has filled in the right wisdom, at least, and it's definitely going to be a milestone in the journey for gender equality.
Taking a cue from what Aishwarya Bhati just said, Satya Prakash, this particular issue has come up in the Supreme Court, correct me if I'm wrong, on three other occasions in the past. I think it was 54, 85 and 88 as well. What did the Supreme Court observe back then? Why wasn't it struck down in the past?
Back then, if I remember it correctly, in one of the judgments, one of the judges had talked about even Article 15(3) to say that it protects women. It treats women as a victim rather than a criminal. So that way the Supreme Court has a very patriarchal kind of understanding of or rather interpretation of this law. Now, we are in 21st century, and judges, many of the judges who are sitting on the bench, they are educated abroad and they have seen the world, and they have seen the moral values, how the society has changed, and accordingly they have interpreted. One particular thing, we are yet to read the complete verdict. We have just flipped through many various pages of the judgment. Some of the comments of Justice Chandrachud could be problematic, where he is talking about sexual autonomy even within the family. That could be problematic. Maybe he is talking about something which we are yet to understand, and we'll read the verdict again, because I considered that we have just flipped through the verdict. But that part could be problematic. If you are part of the marriage, so there has to be some sanctity attached to that institution. If you want to go out, you are free to, but so long as you are within that institution, you should respect the institution, and that, as Aishwarya has pointed out, generally adultery is a consequence of a failed marriage. But if the marriage has failed, walk out of the institution. Don't try to sully the institution, and because it gives a bad name to the institution called family, and sexual autonomy within that family, it could be problematic.
All right. I want to bring in Rahul Ishwar here. I mean, taking a cue from what you just said about how many of these judges are educated abroad, and they're far more learned now, and they've seen the world as well, and they're looking at this from that perspective. That having been said, Rahul Ishwar, is that a fear as well, that we are becoming far more liberal, far more westernized, and it could probably have an impact on the future generations?
See, like Gandhiji once brilliantly remarked, we can definitely open all the windows so that all the air comes from everywhere in the world. But at the same point of time, I refuse to be blown off my feet. Yes, we should have an open mind. We should be open to new ideas. We should be, in effect, liberal and plural. Nobody is saying no. But we shouldn't lose our roots. And our roots are definitely stored in the entire idea of family system. See, I concede that, even though I'm a right conservative person, I concede that especially males in marriage, in Indian context, have been a bit supremacist kind of, some people are chauvinistic. We have to be very realistic regarding that. But what we need is mutual complementarity, better love relationship and harmony. And I think every panelist will agree on this very brilliant point, right, by Sixthus, where he said adultery is a consequence of a failed marriage. That's the reason why he points out, let us address the issue of failed marriages. Adultery is not the cause for failed marriages. Rather, adultery many times is a result of broken marriages, broken families, where people are having loss of connectivity. That's the reason why we need to have interpersonal skill education inside marriage. We need to have family education. I agree with that perspective. And that's the reason
why... What about people who are not in a marriage?
Inside the marriage. The Chief Justice said that. The Chief Justice went on to say that this whole adultery is a consequence of failed marriage or broken marriage.
Fair enough. But what about people who are not in a marriage?
Yeah, there are many, and I'm not the most moralist person in the world, neither am I a very conservative person. At the same point of time, family is the only way that any generation can go ahead. Family is the future. Family is the most successful institution in the human history in the past 5,000 recorded years. So this monogamous family marriage, many other systems were tried. Commune living was tried, polyandry was tried, polygamy was tried. We still know monogamous family is one of the most successful systems. So we need legal, ethical framework which will uphold it. And I'm happy that in spite of losing, the present central government gave an affidavit to that tune, which really satisfied all of us. We know that present central government went ahead and fought for that particular ethical position. I wouldn't even use the word moral, that ethical position, because there are some frameworks and lakshmanarekhas we have believed for centuries altogether, so that families can exist and prosper. And
okay,
that is the thought I would like to put forward. Yes, the verdict has come, but we should also think about such kind of family education laws which will uphold family, and prevention is better than cure. So rather than having a cure or adultery or other things, let us think about prevention where healthy families prosper in India, so that our demographic dividend, our future will be safe and the family as a system will be safe. And please remember, let us not aid the West. See that, for example, Germany, a demographic vacuum is developing in Germany. That's one of the reasons they are taking in migrants too. Family system is collapsing across Europe. They are running short of people. They are running short of babies. They right now acknowledge that family collapse is a very serious issue.
Okay.
And there are many nations...
Points taken. Let me take the points that you're making to the other panelists as well. Satya Prakash is raising his hand. Satya Prakash first, and then I'll come to Yogita. Yeah.
See, there is one aspect about... the threshold when you criminalize a particular act. In this case, I'm talking about adultery. When you criminalize sexual acts, only if there is want of consent, if one of the parties is not consenting, then only you can criminalize such acts. So long as the consent is there and two consenting adults are there, it cannot be criminalized. There could be civil consequences, which even the Supreme Court has admitted that it could be a ground for divorce. So that part, but so long as there are consenting adults, even if one of the parties to the consent is from a particular marriage, it doesn't matter. So consenting adult, and that this threshold, the general principle which applies in criminal law, if that is there, that threshold is met, then it should not be criminalized. And that is what the Supreme Court has said, it cannot be criminalized. There's two things. One is, there is moral concept of sin or religious concept of sin. The other is legal concept of crime. Both are not synonymous. And there are difference. Both are different concepts. What is crime, what is sin need not be a crime, and what is crime could be a sin as well. So this distinction is broadly followed across the globe, and there is a threshold only when that is crossed.
Mm.
And that threshold requires that the broader consequences of a particular act, if that is for the larger society, adverse consequences for the larger society, then only the state will penalize that particular act. Here, two consenting adults, and presuming that one of them is party to some marriage, even if they are indulging in some sexual conduct or misconduct, there are no larger consequences for society as such. And that is why the state should generally keep itself away. And the Supreme Court has rightly recognized that concept.
It has nothing to do with the state is what you're suggesting, as long as two consulting adults, you know, are consenting at the end of the day. All right, Yogita Bhayana, you know, Let's move on from this particular aspect of this particular issue and talk about what needs to be done on the whole for us to move towards a gender equal society. You said it's a step in the right direction. What else needs to be done?
Many, many things yet to be done. However, we are going there, but very gradually. But definitely, it's a fortunate thing or unfortunate thing. I don't know how to say, but court has to intervene. Wherein governments, they need to take it on a head-on war-like situation, because when we talk about rapes, we discuss everything is related to gender separation, gender sensitization, gender equality. Everything has to be brought together since beginning, since childhood, since school days or whatever we can say that. Every sphere of life, and from police to parliament to everywhere. So till the time this equality or how to say, maybe the gap if we fill in, where we take the other gender as equal, or maybe there's no gap altogether, maybe then we are saying we are heading towards there, and we are moving. But as I said, courts are taking cognizance and they are making such judgments. But what about the other spaces, government especially, where is the reservation? I mean, we are, I mean, it's needless to say, we are seeking for reservation. By default, it should be given to us any which ways, the equal opportunities.
You shouldn't be asking for it, is what you're suggesting. Equal opportunity should be given to women as well.
It's a long battle, but still beginning has been done. There's some sign of liberation, I would say rather, but there's a long way to go.
Okay, there's a long way to go is what Yogini is suggesting. Aishwarya Bhati, you know, firstly, how do we bridge the divide, and also the larger picture, of course, what implications is this verdict going to have in the future?
I think, one, it is very important to understand that it continues to be a civil wrong. It continues to be a matrimonial wrong. So it will be treated as cruelty for the purpose of maintenance, divorce, desertion, you know, all the other matrimonial rights, alimony, custody, all those issues. Adultery will continue to be a wrong. And adultery, like it is understood and like it is equal for all, that any sexual conduct or misconduct outside of marriage will be treated as adultery. Only that it is not a crime. So therefore, there is no punishment and no trial under IPC and no sentencing there. Bridging, definitely it's a step in the right direction. Like I said, these kind of judgments, we didn't see too many convictions in adultery. Let me, say upfront it's not like adultery was a very, very high conviction section. Usually adultery section was used where marriages were failing and there was, you know, other matrimonial cases going on between parties. So in practice, the operation was again for failed marriages. So not too many convictions, but at the same time, so not like it'll have an impact there, but a positive step in the right direction towards gender equality, where dignity of women is understood to be paramount and of equal status in the constitution, where treating women as an object, as a chattel of the husband is absolutely impermissible. This is a very, very positive and strong milestone. But the bridge and the divide is still very, very wide. I think what is important is, till the time that one half of our population is not able to go about and, you know, go about their day with safety, with security, fulfill the aspirations that they are capable of. It's not like everybody wants to be an astronaut or everybody wants to be a prime minister. Just fulfill their aspirations, whatever they are capable of, do exactly what they want to do, without the patriarchy binding their legs, acting like shackles, and safety paramount. Just these two things, if the society provides these two things to the woman, then there's no holding back. Every woman will be able to achieve whatever she's capable of achieving.
You know, that's a very valid point that you made. Rahul Ishwar, at the end of the day, it's a man's world. We are a patriarchal society. How do we change that?
I concede that point. You know, there is no for good in denying realities, but we should definitely give more justice and space to both genders. But the only humble request is, along with gender equality, let us also think about gender uniqueness and gender complementarity. Rather than these people conflicting and contradicting each other, we believe gender should be complementary, so that they are like two halves. The two halves, when joined together, makes a family and makes a future generation. So that is the idea of family we all have. We have the idea of Artha Narishwar. That basically means Shiva is incomplete without Sati, or Shiva is incomplete without Parvati. And Parvati is just the other way around too. So So we need that complementarity, and India, Indian philosophy always for millennials proposed the idea of complementarity rather than one gender being on top of or having supremacism over the other. So that complementarity idea should be celebrated, and may the male and female be complementary so that the world moves ahead in a much more better fashion.
Yogita, how do we change the mindset of the people at the end of the day? Now that too is a big problem, isn't it?
So this is the only problem, I would say. It's all about the mindset. Everything else, as I said, laws are taking its places. I mean, we are still going in the right direction in that legal aspect. How do we change the mind? That's the biggest question. When we step out, as Aishwarya very beautifully said, that we need our space. Where is our space? We move out, we are in danger. We never feel safe. So, I mean, the whole thing, governments and altogether people, they have to think about changing the mindset, and mindset would not change overnight, but step has to be taken. But I don't see any government taking the right, steps in the steps in the right directions. So there is nothing has been even initiated on that sphere. People have started their movement. People are doing their whatever bit we are doing as becoming aware citizen. Going towards that, men in the educated society, they are taking the pledge. But what about the other? I mean, other 99% of the population.
I think educated people also do a lot of wrong.
Yes, they
it's,
do.
It's not just limited to the rural folk or uneducated folk.
Somewhat education does help. We can't deny that factor. But at least it is ringing the bells. At least there somewhere. So everything is interrelated. So a lot of things have to be done. That is exactly what I'm saying. So
a holistic approach is what we require. Is what you're suggesting. It's a big country at the end of the day. The progress will be slow, but we have to give the authorities a chance really to try and reform the society as such. Satya Prakash, close the show for us with your concluding remarks.
Well, I would say even in the upwardly mobile urban settings, you find that there is a considerable amount of gender bias against women that needs to change, and people need to be sensitized right from the school time and family. It has to be done at the family level.
It has to be done at home also at home.
Because if you sensitize your children, then they would be growing up as equal citizens, and they would not be behaving in a manner which we generally see on streets of Delhi or some other parts. But so far as judicial or the constitutional part is concerned, we are happy to see that Supreme Court over the decades, it has progressed a lot, and the interpretations they are giving to various constitutional provisions. Look at the irony. And we are happy that Justice Chandrachud, D.Y. Chandrachud, he has overruled his father's verdict. He did it in right to privacy verdict. He has done it over here. I am saying in some aspects, we may not agree with him. But the fact that the constitutional, the generation has changed, and they are interpreting the constitution in a manner which suits the needs of the society. And this was the only aberration in the entire Indian Penal Code. Even bigamy was gender neutral, section 494. And 497, it was full of gender bias. So it has been done away with. It's good. Let's hope that rest of the provisions also and practices where gender biases are there, in due course, the Supreme Court correct all those anomalies and we'll move towards complete gender equality.
All right. Thank you to all my guests for joining me on the program, putting things into perspective for us. What's coming out of this debate is it's a step in the right direction. A lot more needs to be done as far as the society is concerned, and we will be moving in that direction. Thank you for watching. See you again next time.